Heads. I am your host, Russell Glasser, and with me today, I'm pleased to have not one, but two good friends, Tracy Harris on my far right, and Charity Spears, a first-time visitor to the Atheist Experience. Long-time viewers may remember that when my sister Karen used to be on the show, she talked about a neighbor who was raised by two religious parents but was drifting towards atheism, and so I'm pleased to have that neighbor with me today. Charity is now an 18-year-old atheist. Hi.
Hello.
And she's going to be talking to us today about a book series that she had growing up, Left Behind: The Kids. And Tracy, of course, you already know, is our regular co-host, and she'll be helping us field calls. Today is Sunday, January 18th. We are a live public access call-in show offering atheists in the Austin area the opportunity to interact with the public and vice versa. Answering questions, discussing relevant topics, and correcting many of the misperceptions about who we are and what we do and don't believe. The Atheist Experience is sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. You can find out more by visiting www.atheist-community.org. And when you do, be sure to check out the Frequently Asked Questions page for answers to the questions that we hear just about every week. Audio and video from this program are available at the official show website, www.atheist-experience.com. Click on Archive and you'll find a list of programs, including links to both audio and video downloads. The video is provided by Google Video, and YouTube also has some shorter clips if you poke around in there. Also, you can stream the show live as it happens by going to this atheist-experience.com every Sunday, 4:30 to 6 o'clock p.m. Central Time, and you can participate in a live chat room, which I'm pointedly ignoring right now. In addition to this program, the ACA also sponsors a bi-weekly internet audio podcast called The Nonprofits. Visit www.nonprofitsradio.com for more information. That's P-R-O-P-H-E-T. The next episode will be on January 24th, I believe. In addition to our lectures, television programs, and podcasts, the ACA hosts a number of regular social events, including Atheist Happy Hour every Thursday beginning at 7 p.m. at the Dog and Duck Pub, located at the corner of 17th and Guadalupe. There are weekly meetings every Sunday at Romeo's on Barton Springs Road, except for the first Sunday of every month, when you'll find our lecture series at the Austin History Center, located at the corner of 9th and Guadalupe. The next lecture appears to be on February 1st, and last time I checked, there was no topic announced yet. But I'm sure they'll come up with something great. If you enjoy this show, and you would like to join us, I think all three of us will probably be there today after the show. Beginning at around 6:30, we'll be at Threadgills in South Austin. The address is 301 West Riverside Drive at Barton Springs Road, just south of downtown. So we are a live call-in show. We're going to have the number up in a little while. If you are local to Austin, and especially if you're a theist and want to get in some arguments, then we encourage you to call. We encourage people from out of town to get in touch, mainly by email. this show has gained a lot of worldwide popularity from our spirited arguments with theists, and we'd like to have as many of those as possible. So if you're a fan of the show, we'll be happy to hear that by email or during the pre-show, which begins before this one. Let's see. I think that's all. So, as is traditional for the people skimming the video online, pause bars. This is where the boring announcements are over, and you can start up again. And here we have Charity Spears. How are you, Charity?
I'm doing great.
Okay.
Kind of nervous. My first time on anything like this.
Okay.
So basically,
are you an atheist?
Yes, I am.
For how long?
Not for very long. I mean, you go through, I'm raised in a theist household, mm-hmm. as he previously stated, the crazy neighbors. Strong religious backgrounds. You go through a period of doubts and then education, and then you finally come to realize who you are and who you want to be. And I've definitely realized that maybe the path of my parents was not the wisest one, and I've come to choose atheism, yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So, you are going to talk a little bit about a variant of the Left Behind series today. For complete noobs, can you tell us what the Left Behind series is?
The Left Behind series is basically a fictional book series about the end times, the Book of Revelations, and they all start off with the rapture, where all the believing Christians get vaporized into heaven. And the Left Behind series is for all those who are left behind in this time of tribulation, where all those remain have to go under great terror sent down from God, and it's a second chance for all those not originally raptured to come to Christ.
So these people who were left behind would presumably not have been Christians.
Yes.
Or at least not the right ones.
Yes. So basically this is, considering that most of these left behind books are indeed read by Christians, it's kind of a lost audience, but it works.
Okay. What's the kid series about?
The kid series is basically a very diluted version of the adult series. It's based... It's a side story where they get teenagers.
Hold one up. So
there you go. Preteens. This is the first book. It's basically you get the preteens where you get kids maybe 14, 16 having their own little story alongside of the adult story. So I believe there's 40 in the series.
That's what I saw on the web.
So I mean.
40 books.
40 books. Yes. Very thin ones.
So, is there a lot going on in each individual book, or what?
No, there's probably, they have they have 7 years to cover. That tribulation is supposed to go over a time period of 7 years, so...
It's like Harry Potter.
It is, except a lot thinner.
And worse. So, actually, I see from the inside cover that the first book was published in 1998, so
yes.
We're about 10 years out now.
Yes. I think they're... correct me if they're wrong, I think just last year they came out, the last one. But,
I have no idea.
That's what the guy in Barnes & Noble said. So, basically, it works as a preteen dedicated, I think the age is 10 and up. I was raised with him as a kid, and it's the adventure story of all times. And basically, it's a scare tactic. You read these books about how horrible life is going to be after the tribulation. So it's a lot of guilt said in the beginning, especially in the beginning, about how these kids feel guilty that they didn't turn to Christ before the tribulation, and now they have to live in a world without their parents. Or without commodities, or where they turn to become Christians and then they have to be prosecuted.
From what I've read, don't all the kids in the world disappear because they're below the age of whatever?
Discernment, yeah, below the age. I think I'm getting it wrong.
That's me.
Yeah, well, it matters, I guess, what denomination you are. In this series, all the babies disappear.
Ah.
And the young children. It matters which faith you are. I believe under 13, you're supposed to be automatically saved, no matter what.
And the kids in this series would be?
The kids in this series are 13, 14, 16. They do mention kids about the age of 9 or 10 that have been left behind that are especially old for their age. So
in other words, the target audience of this series is exactly the right age to have to go through the tribulation.
Exactly.
Perfect.
So basically, it's now that you can think for yourself, let's make sure that we'll brainwash you in time.
Okay.
It's pretty much that. The first book, basically, is you introduce to the four stereotype preteens. You get Judd, who is the 16-year-old. Then you get Vicky, who is supposed to be the trailer trash. You get Lionel, which is the African-American, which every book must have, political correctness, and you get Ryan, who is the unbeliever out of the group. And it's targeted, three out of these main teenagers are teenagers who rebelled against their parents' faith while they were living in a Christian household. The fourth is the one that was not raised in a Christian household, but was orphaned due to tribulation accidents. So that was Ryan, I believe. Mm-hmm. So it's it definitely, as a kid reading this book, I read them like at age 13. I think I only got to 27.
Slacker.
I know, I'm missing, 13 books? But, I mean, it's definitely, at a young mind, you read these books and you're thinking, oh, I can never be one of those people, but you're entranced with this adventure. In fact, my brother, who is a year younger than I, actually came up to me and decided that he wouldn't want to be a Christian because he wanted to be left behind so he can have an adventure and try to kill the Antichrist.
So these books don't really work very well
no,
from our small sample set.
They don't.
Were you did you consider yourself a Christian at the time you were reading them?
Yes, I did.
And they really didn't work.
No, they did not.
What went wrong?
Well, I can't link my lack of theism towards these books, but I can tell you definitely that, I mean, they are definite, like, obvious fallacies. As Russell likes to talk about, the character who is the Antichrist is probably the most difficult to explain. As long with the rapture, you get the people vanishing into air, and it gets explained away by the Antichrist as radiation, that leftover radiation from all the nuclear bomb testing that has vaporized random people.
Here, I actually have this. I'm going to hype the blog Slacktivist because I really like it. They're going through a long series of reading the books and seeing the movies and just basically blogging the experience. And Slacktivist had an interesting comment in the middle of the movie. He says, wait a minute. Back in New York City, Ivy and her friend, this is from the movie, which is not based on the kids' books, but Nikolai Carpathia, who turns out to be the Antichrist, offers this explanation for the disappearances when everybody vanishes at the same time. He says, "We have confirmed that the disappearances have been caused by accumulated radiation from decades of nuclear weapons testing." That doesn't even try to make sense, but here, as in the book, everyone happily swallows this. And not only do they universally accept this explanation for why random people simultaneously disintegrated, and only people, not plants or animals, but they universally greet as reassuring the news that the atmosphere is filled with undetectable radiation that might at any moment cause them to spontaneously disintegrate too. Where are they? Where are my mother and brother? Where are my children? Oh, don't worry. They disappeared due to accumulated radiation from decades of nuclear weapons testing. Oh, well, okay then. Anybody know what's going on at the movies? So that's about the level of, intellectual discourse from this series, I would guess.
Basically, they're trying to rationalize and bring into modern times a very old text, and it doesn't always fit.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's basically, well, there is a sort of a, through the Christian audience, it's the good mission to save everybody before the tribulation.
Okay.
So they get zapped away before the 7 years. But
is that pretty much the plot after the rapture?
Pretty much. It's their plot to save the world. Basically, this is supposed to be a time where the Christians are persecuted, and they're trying to save the world. I think in the fifth book, they make the kids, actually, they start attending high school again after a couple of months out of school, where with the world in chaos, where they decide to go to school, even though they currently believe that they only have 7 years left to live, in order to try to save all the high schoolers.
What school do they go to?
Nicholas Carpathia High, where the mascot's the Doves.
Oh,
it's lovely. Well, it's the Antichrist.
Right.
Yeah.
And of course, we all know that anybody who tries to bring the world together and bring peace about must be evil.
Yeah, they have a, where is it? I think it's Vicky is talking to her friend, and she's saying, well, anyway, if Bruce is right and there's a peace treaty signed between the UN and Israel, we only have 7 years left to live. So, I mean, that's her valid... Definitely, and they...
By the way, the UN actually appears nowhere in the Bible. I just wanted to set that straight.
It doesn't. It's the fact, I think, it's supposed to be peace in Israel. So I think we're okay for the world ending
so anytime far. Soon. This year.
This year, we're okay. We're okay for at least another 7 years. So, but it's definitely interesting, and you get a... get the Antichrist, which is my favorite. I love the Antichrist in this series. Okay. Nicholas Carpathia, the president of...
Nikolai.
There we are. Nikolai, president of Romania. And he is the incarnation of Satan, which all the kids adamantly abhor.
But they named the school after him?
They named the school after him. But basically, the point that I'm trying to make with the Antichrist figure is the reason why they pin him down as an Antichrist in the first part, first 10 books or so, before he starts raining down fire and controlling the weather, is basically because everybody likes him. So they immediately dub him the Antichrist. So apparently a great politician who wants to unify the world that everybody likes is going to be the Antichrist.
Okay. Tracy, have you read Left Behind?
No, I haven't.
Oh, okay. Have you seen the movie?
I don't feel like I've missed much, though, from hearing this analysis.
No, not really.
No, I haven't seen it. Oh, it's good for a giggle. I can't even imagine. Yeah.
I remember several years ago when the movie came out with the illustrious Kirk Cameron. There was a screening party at my house where we all made fun of it.
Wow.
But
I should just to throw this in there, when I was a Christian, the church I attended did not believe in rapture and tribulation and any of that. So okay. It wouldn't have.
I've actually heard several of my close friends that attend different denominations say that the Book of Revelations is supposed to be an allegory towards the fall of the Roman Empire. It would make more sense.
It makes even less sense, really, because, believing now that Jesus could see into the future, but not that far into the future.
Well, it wasn't written by Jesus.
Okay. Whoever wrote the Bible. But it was supposed to be divinely inspired, right?
Yeah, true. So I guess it was written by Jesus.
One of the things to, I know this is kind of more serious, but it's like one of the things to bear in mind is that whenever Jesus gives a dissertation on end times, it's directly linked to the destruction of the temple at Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
So it always seems to be something that was intended in like maybe the next few decades, which in my mind, if you couldn't see that the temple was going down at the point where, mm-hmm. People were preaching there was a lot of Jewish persecution happening and Rome was trying to figure out what to do with this section of the empire. It doesn't take a prophet to say, wow, there's a bad situation here and it's just getting worse.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can't quote the scripture exactly, but
I may have it here.
Where it's supposed to be within that generation, he's talking to his disciples
that's an interesting discussion.
To come.
It's repeated in every gospel except for John. And he does call it this generation will not pass away until mm-hmm. all these things come to pass. And the coming, he's talking specifically about the coming of man and the destruction of the temple.
Which I've been told by my mother that one of the Johns is still hiding away alive in Easter Island, preserved by God for several thousand years.
Yeah, okay.
Right,
well,
so there's one very, 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 very old guy.
Right.
and therefore, technically,
there is no generations. Minor translation that would be allowable with the term that is race.
Mm-hmm.
And so some people take it and they say, well, it's race. But my response is like threefold to that. It's like, number one, the translators don't agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
The translators translate this generation. And when Jesus talks about you generation of vipers, he's not talking about a race. He's talking about a specific, he uses the term generation in other spots and he means you people right now.
You variety of people.
The other thing is that when he makes his responses, when what he's doing is he's answering, he it's always right after a scene where somebody has come out of the temple, they're admiring the temple, and Jesus starts it out by saying, not one stone is going to be left on another. And he's specifically directing that comment to the temple.
Okay.
And so he makes the comments about the temple, and then the people there say, tell us what are the what how will we know when this is going to happen? And so then he goes into his thing about the signs and the end times. Mm-hmm. The his personal disciples come to him later and say, tell us more. Like what should we be looking for? And he goes into launches into chapter after chapter of, you know, here's all the signs, here's the tribulation,
yes,
and it's all
will be
about
fire and
right.
war
and
it's earthquakes,
all about the destruction
like
of the
like there yeah. usually isn't.
Right, it's all about the destruction of the temple. And when he's saying this generation, he makes no attempt whatsoever to clarify to the people he's talking about that, oh, hey, wait, but I don't mean you.
Yeah.
I don't mean in your lifetime. Because it's obvious. If I think you're not talking about me, I'm not going to ask you what signs should I look for.
Yeah.
Right? If I'm asking you what signs should I be looking for, and you start telling me, obviously, if you know this isn't going to happen to me, that this is going to be 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years later, you're going to say, oh, you don't need to look for anything because you're not going to see it. You're going to be dead.
Right.
So he doesn't ever clarify that. But the other problem is that
this is all incredibly contrived, of course, because you can pretty much make no matter what happens, you can make up anything like a 2,000-year-old guy.
Yep.
I mean, come on. Whose idea is that? The problem with that is, and with all the Bible prophecies, is that it completely eliminates your ability to tell anything in advance. It makes the prophecy completely useless because it could apply to any stretched out definition of the word that you can come up with after the fact. So how is it actually a prophecy?
I think you can associate it with Nostradamus. You end up with very vague, broad symbols marking a pending disaster.
Well, anyway, just to add, it's like just a couple points of clarity. One of the quotes that's also within these discussions is that Jesus is quoted as saying that he's telling his disciples in Matthew 10:23 that they will not finish, going through the cities of Israel until the Son of Man comes. So in other words, they're not even going to be done preaching in the cities of Israel when this happens. So that's fairly immediate. And then the other thing that he says is, truly I say to you, there are some of those who are standing here who shall not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. And the reason I'm stressing this is that there's a type of end times philosophy called preterism. And it's also sometimes called transmillennialism. There's like another version of it.
Oh, yeah.
And what they're saying is that this entire thing already happened. This is all past histories. Second coming, everything happened already. And the way they interpret it is really symbolic, and I'm not going to get into that, but they use these verses to say, if you're holding to some futuristic thing that's going to come and you're still waiting, you have to deal with passages like this. Because these types of, when Jesus is talking to them and he's saying, people who are standing in front of me right now are still going to be alive when this occurs, you've got to explain that.
So books like these, basically Christian texts, are not even validated by the Bible, which is supposed to be the main Christian text.
A preterist and a transmillennialist would say, no way.
No way.
And they are Christians. Yeah.
Yeah, but presumably Jerry Jenkins and Tim LaHaye are not those kind of people.
Right. They hold to a separate interpretation.
Right.
But even then, there's...
But, I mean, a lot of people take the Left Behind series seriously. I mean,
at least 10 million. What was it? copies sold.
Different copies.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure the further it gets, the more copies sell. But, it's a lot of people.
When I was reading these books in a Christian household, my mother would buy these books for me, and my brother would buy them as gifts, and it was taught to me that these books were not only a fictional book based on this religion, but what was going to happen, put into fictional terms, and that I should fear this. Yeah, basically, that this was prophecy.
Okay. So what would you say on the whole is the intent of these books?
And the whole, the intent, I think it's actually scare tactics. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's basically the fire and brimstone version, but instead of going to hell, being left behind, that not only should you get saved to avoid hell, but you should get saved now just to avoid the tribulation, so you don't have to get saved after the tribulation and not have to worry about the Antichrist.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, it's fear and intimidation.
Okay. And?
Oh, and guilt.
Let's see. I guess I'm going to ask again, did it work?
No.
Or can you see it working on somebody else?
I'm a much older audience, and this is what's directed to now, but even as 13, 14, my friends and I read it, but, I mean, we read it as we would comic books. I mean, we thought it was corny and mildly entertaining if we wanted something to read.
Okay.
And something our parents would not be looking disapprovingly on.
Would you say it's good to read for the camp value? Would an atheist enjoy it?
If y'all want to giggle.
Okay.
It's definitely very funny.
In an unintentional way, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, we are a live call-in show, and it's been nearly 30 minutes now. And so if you'd like to call, the number is down there on your screen. If you're too shy to call, you can email tv@atheist-community.org. And we'd love to have you on in the discussion today. So we're going to go to line one and Garrett in Los Angeles. Garrett, are you there?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Hi.
Hello.
I hate to throw you completely off topic, but I'm in a different time zone than I normally watch you on YouTube.
Yes.
And I wanted to correct something Matt said last week about Mandelbrot patterns.
Oh, perfect, because I'm the one with the computer science degree, so go for
it. It's not too technical, is it? Sorry, there's a bit of a double voice, but...
Turn off your volume. Computer sound.
Oh, well, I'm not on a computer, but last week in the overtime period...
Yes?
While Matt was doing his crocheting, somebody called in and made a point about Mandelbrot patterns relating to creationist arguments.
Okay.
And Matt hit him with a creationist smokescreen that kind of obscured the point and made it look like it was a bad point, but it's really not.
Okay.
The Mandelbrot pattern argument is supposed to answer the watchmaker argument.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they say that when you walk along the beach, you see a watch, you think that a person or some kind of intelligence made it.
Mm-hmm.
But you pull out the Mandelbrot pattern to show them that not all complex things have a designer that we can observe.
That's right. Just because something is complex doesn't mean it's designed.
Exactly. And Matt responded by saying, well, maybe God created the math that made the Mandelbrot pattern. But that's not exactly right, because it just obscures that they didn't really find a contradiction in science.
Oh, yeah, okay. Because
within what we observe, there are things that don't have creators.
Gotcha.
Yeah, I guess
what Matt was trying to say was that you could dodge around that by making up an ad hoc explanation that, oh, God created the Mandelbrot series too.
Exactly. But
the whole argument is circular. I mean, they say there's nothing that is complex that doesn't have a designer, and then when you produce one, they say, oh, well, that actually had a designer, so I win.
It's really bad.
I mean, my answer to the complexity argument is, yeah, there is something without a designer, people.
Yeah, and if you try to make a smokescreen, it's kind of like just obscuring the issue, and you feel like you're kind of picking up after a baby or something like that, the way they throw these messes on the floor.
Right, yeah. Well, it's the whack-a-mole strategy. Okay, thanks for calling.
All right, guys, love the show.
All right.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye. Another regular announcement that I don't repeat often enough is after the show you can join us at Threadgills. Somebody will throw the address up on the screen in a minute. There it is. Yeah, go there. So next we're going to go to Ed here in Austin. Hello, Ed.
Hi.
Hi.
You here?
Yes.
Hello.
Hello. I wanted to thank Tracy. For saying what she said a second ago. I've kind of been watching the show and cooking at the same time, so I don't know everything that's been said. I am as particularly like labels, but you can call me a theist if you're comfortable with that.
Do you have a particular flavor of theology?
I'm pretty Heinz 57, to tell you the truth. I kind of grew up in kind of a Baptist with a little bit of... It's complicated.
Okay.
Are you Russell?
Yeah, I'm Russell. Hi.
Okay. Hi, Russell. Anyway, yeah, it's complicated, Russell. I experienced the religious abuse of the fundamentalist right-wing thing, and kind of came out of it thinking that a lot of the assumptions about that kind of theology were dishonest and disingenuous, and that it's really a lot of fascism posing as Christianity. And but right now, I don't go to a Christian church. I go to more like a New Age fellowship. But anyway, having said all that, I wanted to thank Tracy for just pointing out that there's not just one interpretation of these books, Daniel and the Revelations and Ezekiel. It's all mixed together, and that just pointing out that this is not that I heard Russell say that the problem with Bible prophecy, and you went on to say something that I don't remember what it was, but to me, before you say that, you have to pretext that and say the problem is there is the problem with literal interpretation is there is no literal interpretation. There's a lot of different literal interpretations, and people just pretend like they're all saying the same thing.
Right. Well, what I was saying before is it seems to me that if you want something to qualify as a real prophecy, you have to actually nail it down. You have to say, this is what it means, this is what's going to happen. And then you see if that particular thing happens. If you just say a bunch of vague general stuff and then something happens that you can shoehorn in there, that's not a prophecy.
Yeah, I agree with that. Another catch-22 that's funny to me is, you know, the people who, the kind of the Left Behind series people who believe that kind of thing, if you believe that, are you supposed to be trying to stop that from happening? Because if you stop it from happening, then you would make the prophecy not come true. You know, are you supposed to fight the Antichrist? Because if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. And, you know what I mean?
In the book series, they actually do do several attempts to fight the Antichrist.
Well, aren't you trying to change the future that God has already predicted would happen? And, you know, is there a problem
pretty much, pretty much it is kind of a paradox going on there.
Well, yeah. What do they do to try to change the, or to try to stop him? And do they realize that they're not supposed to?
I can't quote specific. I haven't read all 40 books.
Okay.
congratulations. I forgot what your name is in the middle, the new person.
Charity.
Okay, well, I just wanted to congratulate you, not so much becoming an atheist, but from breaking away from what sounds like an abusive religious system that was, I believe that this LaVey God, I don't have a lot of facts and figures in front of me.
It's Tim LaHaye.
I read an article in Rolling Stone about this guy, and he's really like a fascist.
Oh yeah, he's scary.
He's completely right wing. He has a completely separate agenda than peace, love, and understanding, which, you know, to me is what spiritualized self-actualization, you know, which to me is the scientific term for what Christ, Jesus, Gandhi, Martin Luther King, they're all talking about the same thing to me, you know, and it's about, you know, evolving away from all this ignorance and hatred and war and this bullshit that these right-wing Christians seem to be clinging to. And just one more thing I wanted to say, I thought Russell made a really good point about, that if you interpret these scriptures that the Antichrist is going to bring peace, mm-hmm. or going to attempt to bring peace, then goddamn, anybody who comes along with Christ is going to be better than, they're an evil person. This is the Antichrist. We hear it all again. I mean,
exactly.
We hear it over and over again. Anytime somebody starts to bring peace to the Middle East, you know, they're the Antichrist. You'll hear it coming. It's on the internet.
I was going
to
say that.
I was just about to say, that's what I hate referring back to my mother several times, but my mother and my stepfather are pretty intent that Obama is the Antichrist.
Yeah, see, that's fucking evil. That's language. But anyway, I'll let y'all go. I appreciate you letting me talk, man.
Thanks,
Ed. All right, thank you very much for calling, Ed.
Tell him out, I said hi.
Okay. He'll probably watch this later, so he said hi, man. okay. I was going to say something else about the books, but
you can't remember.
Or you can say something else about the books.
I think I've said that's all that needs to be said. I mean, they're okay. To rattle on even more, it's given. I mean, they're scare tactics for the end times and a misinterpretation of the Bible. It's pretty much.
I'd like to just point out that for me, the really interesting thing is that if I'm telling somebody, if I'm teaching my child something that I think is true, mm-hmm. I don't need to use emotional fear tactics to try mm-hmm. to convince them to not question and to just believe and to accept. If I've got the truth on my side, I should be able to, it should mm-hmm. be self-demonstrable. And using something like this to frighten your child into accepting your belief, I agree with that last caller. I think it's abuse. And you're emotionally abusing your child. You're using brainwashing techniques, which to me is like an illegitimate way of promoting truth. Truth should be promoted simply by, you know, demonstrating it. Mm-hmm. If you can't demonstrate it and you merely have to frighten a person into doing what you say, that's not, you don't have the truth.
What you're saying is probably one of the reasons that drove me away from the faith of my parents. The original reason, I later came to do my own research. But, I mean, as soon as I started to realize that I wasn't enjoying what my parents were teaching me, I went to the opposite scale and went completely pagan, Wiccanism,
right.
Satanism even, went to the complete opposite before I balanced back out again.
I'm glad you balanced back out. Because
yeah, absolutely.
But yeah, it's when you teach your children by fear tactics, by brainwashing, as soon as they get out into a more secular world where they have more knowledge available to them, where they're not sheltered, they come to an understanding and then they rebel. They rebel against a forced system, and it is something that has to be led by example if you are to teach it. So, mm-hmm. I mean, I can't say where I would be personally at this day because I went through several different circumstances, but I still say that I would have become what I am today, but maybe later on, or not have gone to such an extreme level.
You're going to give some of the credit to my sister, though?
Yeah, well, Karen Glasser definitely helped me figure out who I was.
All right, go sis.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to take another call. This time it's Sean from New England. Hello, Sean.
Oh, hey.
How are you doing?
I can barely hear you. You're, like, breaking up, but...
Oh.
Anyway.
Okay.
It's a short question. I was just wondering what you think of that new bus ad campaign that's going on. They have these ads on buses that say, there's probably no God, and... you should stop worrying and enjoy life. I was just wondering what you thought of that.
It's the same as Christians posting posters or bulletins on the side of the road saying that there is a God and you're all going to rot in hell if you don't get saved.
I don't think there's anything wrong with either one. I mean, it's just using your money. Yeah,
it's an expression of free speech, and I'm always happy whenever somebody exercises their free speech, even if they're not saying something I approve of or enjoy.
Right. I don't really have an opinion on the particular thing of just saying there is probably no God. I mean, I don't know how effective it is, but you know, people would say that we shouldn't be out here saying things that are negative against Christianity, and we are anyway.
So. things that happen, like, you know, that movie from C.S. Lewis, The Golden Compass, that came out in the summer, I believe.
Yeah.
C.S. Lewis. No, C.S. Lewis did not.
No, The Golden Compass was written by.
Saying it was, like, anti-religious and stuff.
Somebody's going to be mad at me. I thought The Golden Compass was actually more religious because if you get the. I'm sorry, totally different book series, but if you go into the. Last book for the Golden Compass. Philip Pullman. There we go. You get actually a recreation of the Adam and Eve story. It's why I was told it was so scandalous by my theist mother was because this recreation of Adam and Eve actually condones rather than condemns the original sin.
So. Well, from my understanding, Philip Pullman is an atheist, and he was writing to sort of do sort of a reductio ad absurdum on the whole concept. I mean, I guess in the last book, God gets killed or something like that.
God gets killed and reborn because
is that right?
The girl hooks up with the boy.
Okay.
I don't remember it
exactly. Well, you know more about it than I do then. to my shame.
There's a fine line between literature and brainwashing in some circumstances. when a piece of fictional work is being taught as truth, or fictional is being taught as prophecy, rather than a something being presented as a set of ideals.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of like the concept, the difference between teaching about the Bible and teaching the Bible. Mm-hmm. Theists often say that, like, the Bible is banned from public schools. No, it isn't. I went to a public university, the University of California at San Diego, took humanities classes where one entire unit was the Old Testament and another one was the New Testament. The difference there, though, was they weren't teaching that the Bible, you know, this is what happened or this is a bunch of nonsense. They were just teaching it as literature.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that reminds me that people have complained that you can't pray in some schools, but you can pray in school.
Yes,
sure you can.
Yeah, there's no rule.
With the Pledge of Allegiance.
They're trying to take prayer away from school and all that, but
right, you can pray in school. You just can't organize prayer using the school's resources. There's a big difference there.
Well, I think the most schools, you know, they have their own little prayer snuck in there with One Nation Under God.
Okay.
I mean,
well,
it's already a mandatory prayer right there.
Okay.
Yeah, that doesn't need to be there, but it's there. Yeah.
Right. Well, thanks, Joe McCarthy. Okay, thanks for calling, Sean.
All right. See ya.
Bye. Okay, we've got another out-of-state caller, but this one is actually a theist, it looks like. So we're excited to have him on. That would be Mark from Orange County, California. How are you doing, Mark?
I'm doing good. How about yourself?
Very well, thanks.
All right, I was just sitting here watching your show, and I was just curious for all the atheists out there, what if you guys are wrong?
About
there being no God.
Well, what if you're wrong, but Hinduism's right? What if you're wrong,
like a scarier religion,
and Islam's right?
Islam.
Well, I don't mind. I'm enjoying my life as a Christian.
Well, I mean, it's okay for you to find joy in your life in whatever faith you are, but, I mean, it's okay for us to find joy in our life with whatever faith we lack.
But what are you going to think when the rapture happens and you're sitting there and I'm in heaven?
See, you're speaking in certainties.
Yeah,
we don't believe the rapture is going to happen.
But that's what I'm asking you. I'm asking you, what if you're wrong and it does happen?
Well,
I guess I would be left behind in that case.
Yeah, you would be.
That's
true.
If
the rapture happens and there's not a better explanation than accumulated nuclear radiation, then I guess I would have to convert.
The problem with Pascal's wager is that I can ask myself, what if I'm wrong about every single religion out there? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, flipping it around for
so
you, what if you're wrong and you find yourself in the Islamic hell, then what are you going to say?
What if you're wrong and you're reincarnated to a chicken?
I don't mind. I lived a good life, so if I was reincarnated, then I'd be something good.
But Hindus don't think you are.
If I'm living a perfect Christian life according to the Bible, then I would be.
If you're living a perfect Christian life according
to the Bible, you would be stoning adulteresses outside the city walls.
No, that's for heresy inside the church.
I don't know if you've read your Bible, but stoning is actually prescribed for a whole lot of stuff, including
Can you give me some examples?
Yeah, if you have a rebellious son, then the prescription is to stone him to death.
Mm-hmm.
That was for those ages, not current time.
Oh, okay. So, in other words, most of the Bible doesn't actually apply to you. All right, so being a good Christian doesn't necessarily entail actually believing what the Bible says and living by it. It just entails doing whatever you feel like God would want you to do.
It
sounds like there's a lot that you could be wrong about. I mean, if it turns out that you die and stoning rebellious teenagers is the right thing to do, then you could be in a lot of trouble. So I hope you're right.
All right, I got a second question. What is your view on the origin of the world?
Well, I mean,
we were just talking with some guy right before the show about the what was it, the fecund universe, the universe is generating out of black holes. That was kind of cool. Of course, we don't know.
I mean,
that's pretty much the answer.
With the origins of the world, I mean, neither an atheist nor a theist theory can fully explain it. I mean, it doesn't go either way. I mean, you can't prove or disprove God creating the world, but neither can you, like, I don't think, there's evidence for the Big Bang Theory, but I don't think you can prove the Big Bang Theory right now either.
What I would probably answer to that is that what an atheist believes about how the world, the existence of the world and how it came to be is going to be unique to every atheist. There is no, like, atheist doctrine of how the world came to be. If an atheist wants to believe a cosmological model, then they will. And I mean, they would probably go ahead.
So the origin of the universe is relative to every atheist?
I'm not saying that the origin itself is relative.
No, the actual origin isn't relative.
But
the answer is we don't know
right
now.
Might accept about it is a personal thing. That's all I'm trying to say. There isn't like a doctrine like there would be in, you know, if you're raised Baptist and they teach you that it's a literal 7-day creation. There's nothing like that in atheism. It's simply up to the atheist to research it and come to whatever conclusion they think is best.
And there are actually a lot of scientific hypotheses out there about what might have happened at the origin of the universe. But the fact is, when you trace sort of the Big Bang back through history, you run up against a wall at this thing called the Planck time, I think, 10 to the minus 43 seconds, where the laws of physics basically fundamentally change because everything's compressed into a very small space. And what happens in that 10 to the minus 43 seconds, we don't know. There's not really a good way to investigate it.
All right. Well, nice talking to you.
Okay.
Well, thanks for calling.
Thanks
for calling. You've been a very nice caller, Mark.
You have a nice day.
Okay. Well, we seem to be getting mostly out-of-state calls today, but we enjoyed that one. And since we've only got one call on the line, rather than having to just fill time, you want to take Greg from Winnipeg?
Sure.
Okay. Greg, you're on.
Hi. I'm kind of like an atheist from birth. I was raised in a very fundamental Christian home, and I just never really believed. It just never, the whole thing, even at like 5 years old, just was completely ludicrous to me. And so I'm kind of wondering, from fellow atheists, if you were theists at one point, how did you arrive at your current conclusions, that kind of thing?
You want to start, Tracy?
Yeah, I've got to make it concise.
Yeah.
But I mean, I was raised in the Church of Christ from as far back as I can remember, and probably battled with belief like in my early teens, finally accepted it in my late teens, held on to it through half of college, finally started to run into information that contradicted what I had been told about, like, canon origins and things of that nature. And when I began to research it in order to actually refute the claims I was running up against, what I found is that what I had been taught was incorrect, and that the actual teachings were that this was an unreliable set of documents, and that it's just nothing that I believed held water. I held on to theism after that, but of course left the church at that point, realizing that the Bible was not trustworthy and that it was just simply put together by a bunch of people. And I went on to study multitudes of religions, took anthropology while I was in college, including anthropology of religion, studied human communication, inter and interpersonal communication, began to learn more and more about how people think, how people communicate, and that has a lot to do with, in my mind, the religious messages and how people interpret them versus how they're expressed. Finally came to the idea that I had to figure out what it was I was calling God in order for the statement, I believe in God, to make any sense at all. And when I tried to define God, I finally came up with the idea that the only thing that to me made sense was that God was everything, in which case it was the universe. Thought I might be a pantheist for all of a week and then realized I was an atheist. That's the short version. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jordy.
Oh, well, I think I kind of explained mine briefly earlier, but basically, originally, I've begun to doubt my faith out of rebellion because I was kept in a sheltered household and not taught anything else. So when I realized there was other things, I kind of was mad that I didn't get to know any of it and went straight into the occult. But then realizing actually it's probably the occult that drove me to atheism, because a lot of it was frankly quite ridiculous. And I apologize to all you pagans out there, Wiccan, Satanists, whatnot, but it sickened me. And I went to research a whole bunch of religions and came upon the idea that divinity couldn't be a specific person thing. That, I mean, the idea of divinity was so broad and so controversial that it's just no argument could really make sense with itself, that it was probably better that God probably either didn't exist or did exist as a universal, ubiquitous, uncaring power that may or may not exist. It just...
Can I ask you a question about your personal journey? Did you run up against, like, philosophy, like trying to define things such as what am I calling existence? What is the nature of existence? What is...
I didn't question existence as much as I did divinity. Like, I read a lot on Greek philosophy, the Epicureans, I loved them. Basically, how could God be defined? I mean, right. Who was it? And then looking at religions throughout history and how God was also manipulated through politics, right. Through philosophy, and that God seemed to not interact with the people or just not be what we conceived divinity to be.
Okay.
So.
I always say my story is the most boring one here. My parents are both physicists, or both have physics degrees anyway. And my father is a strong atheist, and my mother is sort of a non-committal Jew. I say non-committal. She did a lot of the ceremonies and rituals. I had a bar mitzvah, but she never strongly pushed the God angle, and so my father won. I'm an atheist by default. I tried to investigate the claims of religion sometime around college just to see, basically like the last caller said, what if I'm wrong? So I tried to figure out a way to make it testable because, you know, I was raised in a scientific household. Couldn't come up with anything useful and, stayed an atheist. So that's it. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, that was really cool. It was great finding more about your personal experiences. I love that. That's great. Thanks.
Okay.
Well, good. Thank you.
Thank you for calling.
Bye.
Let me see here. We've got somebody else from Canada, but rather than go over that, I want to fill time while we wait for more calls to be lined up by reading something else from Slacktivist about the Left Behind series. Just a comment here, and I apologize to the author of this blog for shamelessly stealing his material. But just a comment here about the whole notion of this guy Nikolai Carpathia, who is the, you know, peace bringer, the charismatic guy who brings the entire world under one government, and then betrays them as the Antichrist. He's writing here. The aim of this scene is to make some kind of sense that Nikolai would be the go-to guy for the network reporters seeking comment immediately after the event, everybody disappearing. And that's a tall order, because even if the president of Romania were as charismatic as a young Robert Redford, he would still be the president of Romania, which is to say he would be a foreigner. And Americans, particularly American reporters, aren't interested in what foreigners have to say. It's kind of impossible to imagine any plausible scenario in which the president of Romania is who they'd want to hear from in the immediate aftermath of the abduction and disintegration of all their children. It's unlikely that the president of Romania would even be sought out for comment by the American media if the event had been confined to Romanian children.
even apart from any America-centric parochial tendencies here, and it makes sense that in times of national tragedy, people would want to hear from their own leaders. The filmmakers hope to skip that step by killing off America's leader, but that doesn't work. If the loss of the president were added to the trauma of the event, Americans would have an even more urgent need to learn that someone here, was in charge. Yeah. And they would need to hear from that person, not some thickly accented guy with no standing here who comes from a place that most of us couldn't even find on a map.
You know, what I think about funny about this is... Yeah. According to the book of Revelations, the Antichrist is supposed to come from Rome.
Yeah.
So you end up with the Romanian guy.
How does that fit in with the Obama thing?
I don't know, but I think the Obama thing is that he's born from a Muslim and I think a Jew, but nobody can prove if its mother is Jewish or not.
But yeah, you can make up.
Yeah,
just
I was
about
actually
anything.
Wondering that same thing when she was talking about the books.
Right.
I was just like, so did this guy, like, did Romania become really powerful in the future?
Apparently not.
He just
talks real good.
They
and based on the last
good.
8 years, we know how much importance we
talks
put on that.
Good okay.
Well, I mean, the book explains it away as him being the one with all the answers,
mm-hmm.
which, of course, a scientist doesn't come up with the radiation that
yeah.
President of Romania does. So.
Another thing you have to realize about these books is that the people who are likely to be reading them are probably thinking they're not the ones left behind. So there's actually no need to make any characters actually believable or relatable because they're not the people you're supposed to have related to.
Well, like that could apply in the adult Left Behind series, but
yeah.
the kids series, as I okay. said, it's like audience towards the kids who are doubting in a Christian household, basically
gotcha.
Smacking them back into order.
Right.
So.
Okay. Oh, who do we want to take more? All right, Ryan's first. Go, Ryan. Ryan in St. John's, Canada.
Thank you. Thanks very much. I just had one little point to say there. I only read one of the Left Behind books. I read the first one. And I think this came up earlier. The reason that they explained it, why they kept on trying to either kill the Antichrist or disrupt his plans, was not to actually stop the calamity that was coming, but was so when he doesn't die from, you know, the assassin's bullet or whatever, then other people will get the point and believe that he was the Antichrist. It kind of flags it up to everyone else. And the reason I think they said in the book for him, everyone going to him for answers was he was the rotating president, just becoming the new rotating president.
The rotating president?
For the UN.
Of the EU.
Oh, I see.
The UN in the books.
Yeah, okay.
So it's not very believable that they would still go to him. And one other thing I just wanted to say from up here in Canada was it'd be an awful shame for you guys to lose Obama at this point. And it would be a really telling thing if the people that want him dead or think he's the Antichrist are Christians, right? I would be... it would be incredibly embarrassing for someone
standard
to
disclaimer, we
and
don't
have a fundamentalist religious person be responsible for
standard disclaimer, as a nonprofit organization, we don't have an official political position. Having said that, I think we all agree that killing world leaders is bad.
Yeah.
So.
Thanks for the call.
Thank you.
Thanks.
The problem with the wanting to just shoot bullets at the Antichrist to see that he's surviving it, to show the world that he's the Antichrist,
right.
is rebutted in the own books. Like, especially in 27, where the last one I read at,
yeah.
where the Antichrist declares himself God. So the idea that the people would be trying to force him to display magnificent powers would probably only support his claim to divinity. So it's kind of a catch-22 right there.
Yeah.
But it is an interesting idea because it's like, well, if evil people can do wonders and miracles, like, how do you know that what you think is God that does wonders and miracles isn't an evil thing?
That's the, like, the different, the, apparently they're supposed to be, like, I don't know, I'm...
Do you know what I'm saying? It's yeah. like, if I believe that signs and wonders are a sign of evil, like an evil being, mm-hmm. or can be the sign of an evil being, then what would be my grounds for saying, well, if Jesus did signs and wonders, then he, you know, obviously was the good Son of God.
Well, wasn't there, like, there'd be many others that'll perform signs and wonders in my name, and that'll lead you astray or something like that?
Yeah. No, I'm just saying, it's like, how would a person be expected to judge mm-hmm. a good, like, miraculous being from an evil miraculous being, especially one that comes bearing peace to the world,
yeah.
right? Which
yeah,
wasn't,
really
wasn't
well,
the Pax Romana.
Well, luckily, he warned us in the Book of Revelations that this guy would be coming. But what
if,
I've always thought is interesting
God,
is
right?
what if the Book of Revelations was actually written by
right,
the Antichrist?
Right, as a means to thwart the real good divinity that was to come, to try
right.
to turn us against it.
Well, I mean...
that's
that
the next
could
book.
Be problematic.
Yeah. Start your own series.
I was hoping to find a news series before a news story on this before taking our next caller, but I couldn't find anything specific except that a lot of you have probably heard that the Texas State Board of Education is currently still in the middle of hearings, I believe. Does anyone know about this? Mark. You don't know anything about it. Okay, but we're going through revisions to the science standards again, which again want to cram into evolution textbooks this watered down disclaimer about teaching strengths and weaknesses of the theory, which really means teach evolution, but then pretend that there's a whole lot of serious problems with it, which is the latest incarnation of trying to get intelligent design into schools. I believe the State Board of Education is now populated by more than half creationists, thanks to some really successful lobbying efforts. So just wanted to let you know we're screwed. I don't have anything to do about it right now.
Humorous, but actually my I just recently graduated high school and my...
Oh, so you're safe.
I'm safe, yeah, I'm okay. No, but I went to a small charter school, and my science and mathematics teacher who taught me throughout the duration of me attending that school was actually a Baptist minister.
Hmm. Okay.
So, I mean, it...
What did he have to say?
Well, he actually was quite diplomatic about it.
Okay.
He would get up in front of the class, tell us this is what he believed, like, well, he vague about what he believed creation, and this is what he doesn't believe in, but he's required by the state to teach it to us.
Right. Do you think he taught it accurately?
I don't know. You should probably quiz me.
Yeah,
I have a question. You say it was a small charter school. Was it a religious school?
No, it's not. It was actually made for ice skaters, young ice skaters who wanted to go to
the school. So it's a charter school, and you had a Baptist minister teaching science?
We had a Baptist minister teaching science. We had a...
And he said in the class that he accepts creation.
Well, and it's a small school, but the fun thing about the school I did attend is the... head of the history department was Muslim. The head of the English department was Catholic. It was a diverse school.
I guess I just find it interesting that wouldn't be like a piece of information required in the course, and yet it would get injected into the course. Not really as course, but even as discussion.
Yeah, well, it was, since it was such a small school, there's 5 students in that class.
Wow.
So, I mean, it was just, the teachers can't keep secrets with that small of a school. So it was something already known.
Okay. So I did want to throw out that topic by way of giving a preamble to our next caller, Andrew from Kansas. Andrew, what you got?
How you doing?
Fine. Hello?
Hello.
I'm doing a paper on intelligent design.
Sorry, we're
going to
put you on hold.
I've been, looking at a lot of...
I think people out there might have heard us already, but we lost the audio from the calls. Can somebody come in here and look at that real quick? Okay, so...
Well, if you want to talk about
Do you want me to put Andrew back on the air while you do that? That's awkward.
Well, if y'all want to talk about religion in schools. I didn't always attend a small charter school.
Okay.
You have to, that's probably been discussed a lot on this show, but the literature wars in schools where you get the school boards wanting to take out Harry Potter, wanting to take out the Golden Compass out of the schools.
TTYL is the latest one, but that's a different issue.
What is TTYL?
TTYL is like the latest book ban.
Oh, I haven't heard of it.
It's, they think that it's too sexually explicit.
What is it?
Oh, it's a book in, I think it's middle school level.
Oh, okay.
Well, I mean, if something's too sexually explicit for middle schoolers, I can understand why that would be.
But it's written for them. Oh. I mean, it's at their grade level. And it was like one parent complained and then like other types of that type of parent complained.
How explicit exactly is too sexually explicit for middle schoolers? What's in there?
I don't know. I've not read it, but I just remember when I was at that age, they were they wanted to ban gender law. So it's just it's like the thing where some of the kids don't act like model kids, and therefore the book should not be read.
Right.
Because, you know, obviously if you write about kids not behaving like they should be, you are promoting that.
I want to ban Left Behind because it has Nikolai Carpathia in it, and he acts like a bad guy.
It's not a ban because they're not saying that it be removed completely. They just want it behind the counter and by request. No, okay. I think that my personal opinion is if you don't want a book in a school library that is age appropriate and that the librarian has determined is appropriate for the library, you can tell your child not to read it out.
I don't know. I'd like to that would make more sense. Obviously, the bans are not working that efficiently.
No, they won't.
Considering that, like, freshman year, I attended Vista Ridge High School, and in the nonfiction area of the books, there is a book that was favorite passed around amongst the freshmen that had the word sex covered 2/3 of the page.
So it's the size of like, oh, hey, sounds like we maybe got a caller back.
Hello, Andrew?
Yes.
Andrew?
Oh boy.
Can you hear us?
We thought we had somebody. Uh-huh.
Wait, let me try this again. Hello?
Andrew? Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
Oh, hi, what happened?
Well, we had you for a second.
Okay.
If you get back on, spit it out real quick.
Okay, so as far as I can tell, the people who are watching at home can hear him, but we can't.
Man. Oh, fun.
And they asked me to listen to the stream live on the computer, but that's not going to work because it's going to be delayed and we're going to hear ourselves. I don't like that solution.
Okay.
All right, so we have 23 minutes to fill. So I'm going to first of all give the announce that if you'd like to get in touch. What?
How about you talk to people in the chat room?
I could talk to people in the chat room.
Like, relay what they're saying.
That kind of sucks. Not that the people in the chat room suck, but you see the pace of the chat room
with
is
the yo
fast.
Yo yo.
Yeah.
We love you. Yay.
No, we do Sad not face. Suck. Why not take questions from chat folks? Okay.
I think we could take questions as long as there are questions.
We're going to take questions from the chat room.
Take one
George in New York was on the line, so and we love George.
Do we have any questions that were up on the board?
What?
Was there any questions up on the board, like for the calls?
On the board?
That we could answer.
Oh, yeah, okay. So we can actually take the last three people's topics.
If they gave a topic, maybe we could just give an idea. I mean, we can guess what they may have meant. Here we go.
Okay. So Andrew from Kansas has advice about combating intelligent design in school.
Which we can't really guess about.
But he doesn't say anything specific about that. And George in New York wants to say why people should not read the Left Behind series.
I don't know. I think
and that's not going to help.
Entertain yourself.
Okay.
But, yeah. Wow, this is the best TV show ever.
No, I mean, I can talk a little bit more about TTYL.
Oh, please.
My point on that was that part of the reason books like this get in trouble with parents is because they are popular. Mm-hmm. And so the parents see them, and the kids are reading them, and they're talking about them, and the parents find out about it. And then the wrong parent finds out about it who mm-hmm. thinks that they're going to parent by stopping everybody from reading the book or by saying, I don't want this anywhere where my kid can get it because they don't have sufficient dialogue with their child. And I'm going to say it's like they in their minds, they don't have sufficient control to tell the child, don't check it out.
Right.
Because if you believed that you could tell your kid, don't check it out, and they wouldn't check it out, there wouldn't be a problem. You could just say, don't check this book out.
Yeah.
But here's the issue.
There are probably a lot
more objectionable books that just don't enter the radar.
Like the Bible.
Yeah, well.
Okay.
Nobody reads that.
Yeah, I mean, but there's, and I, when I say the Bible, I'm not being facetious. It's like, do you want your child to read about Lot and his daughter?
It's incest.
Yeah. I mean, is that really something you want your 13-year-old reading about sex with her dad? You know, is it promoted because it's in the book? Come on, you know, it's like, if you're not going to say that for your own book, don't say it for other books. But with TTYL, if that book is that popular and you get it behind the counter at the library, and you, let's say you even were able to take it out of the library, even though you say that's not what you want, let's say it was removed from the library, there's going to be kids whose parents don't mind if they read. Uh-huh. And so the kid who has the book, your kid, guess what, is going to borrow that book from the kid who has it, and they're going to read it behind your back. So you could either let the kid read it and maybe, I don't know, be a parent. Read the book with your kid and actually talk about the book and ask your kid what they think about certain behaviors in the book. What do you think about this girl that's acting like this or that? Or do you think this is going to lead to problems?
Do you have kids? You don't, right?
No, I was a kid for a while.
Well, I know. But I want to slightly disagree with this very common suggestion from people who don't have kids, which is... Yeah, it sounds easy, like easy advice to say, oh, just screen every single thing that the kid's going to read. That's not really very practical.
Well, I'm not saying you should screen everything. I didn't mean to imply that you should screen everything they read.
Right.
But if you know off the top that this is something that you object to,
right,
and you know your kid is likely to be able to get it, it's not illegal, and your kid is going to get her hands on it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're either going to have her reading it where you're not around to talk to her about it, and where maybe some of her friends are going to be around to talk about the book with her, other 13-year-olds, and what kind of advice is that going to be, and what kind of a context is that going to be? Or you can talk about the book with the kid while they're reading it, and maybe you can read it with them. I don't think that every book my kid reads I need to be concerned about, but certainly there's going to be certain books, and if I've heard something, then yeah, I'm going to take an interest in that. And I think that's parenting.
Well, there's... I lived in more extreme households than some people have here. And
seriously,
have you heard of the book burnings? Karen
no.
may have told you about that.
No.
My mother used to periodically raid my room for books, and I love reading, and I've read almost every single piece of literature I could get my hands on. And a lot of it she didn't like, so she would raid my room and constantly, with my brother's help, find all the different hiding places, collect the books that she didn't approve of,
mm-hmm.
and burn them. And
wow.
Yeah, so she would burn books on, I had a lot of books on Wiccanism. She's burned not only that, but she's burned tarot cards and stuff that she felt that we didn't agree with. And I mean, I think that if she did discuss some of this stuff with me, then I may have not have went so far out to find the books, because just because she burned it, I wanted to go read it.
Right. And did you have trouble finding it again?
Oh, no.
Thank you.
Exactly. I borrowed it from friends.
And did you discuss
it
with your mom?
No.
Did you feel like you could go to your mom and talk to her about it?
I hid the books.
Okay. There you go.
You hide them. I mean...
You're either going to have a kid who feels like they cannot dialogue with you, they cannot talk with you, they have to hide things from you and lie,
mm-hmm.
or you can interact with your child and be a parent.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we're being giving an alternate solution on callers. They're going to play it from another speaker real loud from far away.
Oh, no.
We're going to try, and we're going to give Andrew in Kansas a third try. Are you there, Andrew?
Hello? Can you hear us?
Hello? I hear us. Andrew?
Andrew. Is he talking or not?
He's not live. He's not live. The L light's on lit.
What?
Wait a second. He's not live? Is he even on the line, or did he hang up? Was he on 3?
All right, I'm going to put this one on hold and switch to George on line 1. George, can you hear me? Hello?
Hello?
Hello, Russell?
Yes,
there we go.
Russell, Tracy, can you hear me?
Barely, but yeah, go for it.
Okay, well, I guess the demonic forces have struck, and this time they hit the phone system.
Yeah, that's what they did.
Yes, it's possession.
I mentioned a fellow the other time I called in and spoke to Matt by the name of Dr. Bob Price. He's a famous Bible geek.
Yeah, I know Robert Price.
Okay, I don't want to come across like his literary agent.
Oh, we lost you again. Wait,
turn that
on.
Okay, go ahead.
Do it again.
I don't want to come across like his literary agent, but Bob Price wrote a book on this very subject recently called The Paperback Apocalypse, where he covers the Left Behind and other recent series, and I strongly recommend it if you've not read it.
So you're not saying don't read this series. You're just saying instead of that, you probably would want to pick up Bob Price's book first.
I'm saying you might want to read them side by side with Price's book as a study guide and sanity preserver. The problem with Left Behind that I had is that it completely stinks, if I may use high-grade literary terms.
Did you read it?
Yeah.
How much?
Well, the thing of it is, you would think that with given that cast of characters, you could write a pretty gripping yarn, but apparently it was beyond their abilities. I prefer Randall Flagg from The Stand over that fellow from Romania. It was just, frankly, it was just intolerably bad writing.
I didn't even like The Stand that much once Randall Flagg entered into it.
You have to read the unedited 9 million
pages. And then when I read it again as an adult, I was like, it's not the greatest literature I've ever read.
Well, the thing is, I'm a lifelong atheist, and so introducing demons into a story doesn't really scare me that
much. But then again, I can't compare it to Left Behind.
Yeah.
So somehow I'm feeling that I'm a little young for this.
What?
Stephen King. He's still writes,
I like the first third of The Stand, and you might like it too.
Yeah.
But you were actually saying something to me about the writing style of Left Behind earlier.
Yeah, it was
the kids' books.
It's they do dilute it. I mean, they you read it and you feel like you're being stupid.
Uh huh.
It's just so. And there's parts where it is kind of stilted, because it is written by the authors of the Left Behind series for the adults.
Yeah.
But not surprisingly enough, it's not that bad as much as you would think it would be.
Uh-huh.
But you do get points where you get one of the main characters is Vicky, who is the trailer trash bad girl. And definitely doesn't talk like that, nor think like it. So it's not... it's not valued for its contents. It's not valued for its writing style.
So, do they pretty much come across like a very old person writing what they think kids would find cool?
Sometimes. Obviously, they did their research, but they're still kind of slipped up here and there. I mean, you get her. You get Vicky regretting that she was trying to act like she was 20. Which I doubt that any 14-year-old would say that or even consider it in their mind.
We've got a bunch of weird music now.
I thought I turned that off. Oh, it's supposed to be off.
Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, the joys of public access television. We're cursed.
Technology. Hit the silent button, as you know, silent.
Yeah.
Sorry, ladies and gentlemen, I just got a new cell phone and it doesn't like being quiet.
So we're giving up on that speaker. Are we giving up on calls entirely?
No, I relay it to you.
Conflicting messages.
You can summarize. I can use what? A specific question.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Do that.
We're going to do it. Was it a translation?
Did you send me something already?
Well, I'm assuming this means that people in the chat room can send us specific questions and we'll talk about it.
Yeah, they can. But
I think they're relaying
luckily,
calls, right?
What?
Did he say they were going to relay the call messages?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
But actually, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go back to the Slacktivist blog and find some other fun stuff to read. let me see. Oh, boy. this is, Kirk Cameron is the star of the Left Behind movie series. Mm-hmm. You've seen the movies, right?
Yes, I've seen the movies and then the prequels, the sequels.
Wow, you must have really liked them.
Sure.
That sounds good.
Let's see. There was a profile done on Kirk Cameron in 2003 where Kirk Cameron says he describes his life before being saved. He says, "There was this aching, empty feeling that left me very disillusioned with the business I was working in," he said. "What else was there? What did I have to shoot for? I'd basically reached the top of the ladder, and I was 18. He had reached the top of the ladder. Cameron said, and he still seems to believe that's true. That's an astonishing thing for him to believe when you realize that at about the same time he was being introduced to the newest member of Growing Pains cast, which would be Leonardo DiCaprio. Now, certainly Leonardo DiCaprio's work as Luke Brower Seaver, which is that show's cousin Oliver, wasn't on the same level of the quality of work that he would later go on to do, but he was already clearly a talented and committed actor. Just 1 year after Growing Pains was canceled, he was astonishingly good in What's Eating Gilbert Grape, so I think it's safe to assume that he was already an obviously better actor than Cameron at the time they worked together. Is that going out on the air?
Whoops.
So, for at least 1 year of his professional life, Kirk Cameron was confronted regularly by an example of what a real actor his own age should look like, and yet he spent all that time on the same set with and in the same scenes as DiCaprio without apparently learning anything, without even seeming to realize that he needed to learn anything. I don't want to rub this in too much, but just to clarify why I find this top-of-the-ladder comment so astounding, try to imagine an alternate universe in which Mike Seaver and his adopted brother trade their future roles. Can you imagine Leonardo DiCaprio playing Buck Williams? Okay, now can you imagine Kirk Cameron playing Romeo or Howard Hughes? Okay, I'm going to check on the chat room. What's up? I'm not seeing anything here, guys. The channel that you've directed me to, it does not seem to be working.
I could talk about my jar experiment that I was going to bring.
Talk about your jar experiment.
What? Feel on the call screen. Steve's typing in right now.
Oh, okay.
All right.
All right. Andrew in Kansas wanted to know, do you think going the way of an ontological argument is the right way of handling ID in school? Can you remind me of the ontological argument?
God, don't ask me that.
I need more details, folks.
Don't ask me.
I believe the ontological argument basically tries to define God into existence. Isn't that the one? It's basically, imagine you have a perfect being who is, you know, in all ways wonderful. And then one of those qualities that he has must be existence, because if he didn't exist, then he'd be less than perfect. Therefore, God exists. It's a delightfully circular argument, but I don't see how it applies to the intelligent design discussion.
The only problem I have is I can't... The titles of the arguments escape me. Like, I'm not good at identifying them by titles.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that's the ontological argument or not. But,
okay. I can look it up on Iron Chariots, which is a fabulous wiki.
Resource that we get to demonstrate right now.
Yes. A fabulous wiki set up by originally me, Matt, and a listener. There have been lots and lots of people who have come on and contributed discussions. So, ontological argument. It's compelling.
Kapow. What do we get?
The classic ontological argument for the existence of God runs as follows. God is the greatest imaginable being.
You had it.
All else being equal, a being or entity that exists is greater than one that doesn't. Therefore, God exists.
But of course, you have to have step one.
And of course, the counter arguments... let's see. So we can define unicorns into existence,
right,
in the same way.
But the question, though, what was he saying? Do we think that it was a good way of addressing ID in schools?
I don't know what he meant.
I don't get that either. I don't know if that was a misinterpreted thing or...
Maybe.
So here's my proof that a unicorn exists. And I actually wrote this passage. So let's define a unicorn as a magical equine being that has one horn and exists. By the above definition, such a being must exist. Therefore, a unicorn exists.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the ontological argument.
It's very hard to believe that there are people that use that.
Uh-huh.
But there are.
The fact that the idea is there that... So I can believe that I'm green and polka-dotted?
Apparently. Okay. As long
yes,
as...
apparently.
So, okay, ladies and gentlemen, I am green with purple polka dots.
Uh-huh.
And since I have stated that, therefore it must be true.
Since you can imagine
yes.
it. Yeah.
Since, yeah.
Somebody's trying to call me, but I'm not
going
to assume
that it has
anything
to do. So you're
smart
to actually know how to put your phone on vibrate.
Yes, right. I am smart. So we have 5 minutes, and if you thought that this sucked... And you can email tv@atheist-community.org. You can also join us at Thread Gills. We'll be leaving in 5 minutes to all go and have a good laugh about how the powers that be handled this show. And by the powers that be, we of course don't mean our wonderful producers. We mean the idiots who work it. No, we love them too.
I have a comment on a piece of email we received.
Okay.
I didn't respond to it because I couldn't tell if it was a joke or not. It was too ironic to respond.
Tell me about it.
The person wrote in and they said, why do you only ever take calls from ignorant theists? Basically, his complaint was, why don't you ever take a call from like an intelligent theist?
Have an intelligent theist call.
Well, first of all, the real answer is we take calls from whoever calls in. And if they call in and they're seriously calling with a serious comment, we don't judge like whether or not they're, too ignorant to speak. Like anybody that calls in with a serious comment can call in and comment, and we will talk to that person. Mm-hmm. But the thing that got me was you've got a person defending theism, basically saying these calls you get from theists out in the public, well, those people are idiots. Right. And I'm going, do you not understand that you just said that like the general theist sitting on a sofa in his living room in this, at least in Austin or whoever, it's like that you're calling them ignorant, and this is the standard believer.
It's not our fault that we have people call in and don't represent themselves.
But I wouldn't even insult the theist callers in that regard to say, what a bunch of ignorant people call the show. I mean, I have more respect for these people than the writer who's supposedly defending their stance.
Yeah, well, of course, people call in, people write to us, they've just seen the, the famous clip with why don't you get electrocuted in the
down,
shower.
And the sun goes down.
And they get... We've been accused of making up that call.
I understand why. Who would believe?
These are the real people.
Right.
We have had one person deliberately crank call us, and that was my fault.
Right. And we owned up to it.
Yes.
Right? It was owned up to later on the blog, and
Yeah. Those people you see on YouTube, they're real.
As far as we know.
Really doing that badly. And, On the same note, people also send us messages saying, oh, why don't you get some, apologetics badass? Like, why don't you get Lee Strobel on the show and have him sit next to you and debate? And, okay, first of all, this is an atheist show.
Right.
Lee Strobel can get airtime anytime he wants to.
Right.
And just setting aside a block of time to have him talk uninterrupted for a while, it's not really what the show is about.
Yeah, the theist message.
Second
has
of all,
time.
If Lee Strobel wants to call in, if you guys know Lee Strobel, get in touch with him and tell him he can call like anybody else. We will discuss it with him. We won't hang up on him until he starts being a jerk. we're happy to take those kind of calls. Hey, we're saved by the closing credits. Thank you to our wonderful crew, whom we really do love a lot, especially their hands. Their hands do a lot of great work right there. Meet us at Threadgills so that you can get your questions out. Email tv@atheist-community.org. Matt will be on next week with someone else who I haven't bothered to look up. And thanks, everybody, for watching. Bye.
Bye.